Well, welcome to Speechless. We got a whole hodgepodge of things going on, and we are live from the SCC studios in White Bear Lake, and also live in St. Paul over SPNN. And actually, SPNN is changing locations, so I actually don't know if we're live tonight there. You don't know? Okay, so we heard there was some trouble with the other shows, but... that's the way it goes, you know. You change buildings and things don't always work right and right away. All right, a lot of stuff going on that we're going to talk about. Actually, not going to talk about some family law issues. we'll get to some here, but I'm going to delve into areas I don't like to delve into because I want to stay on judicial accountability and family law reform. But in order to have judicial accountability, family law reform, one very important issue needs to happen, and that is you need to have a transparent government, and you need to be able to access the court's records, the government's records, the executive branch, the legislative branch, so that you can find out what's really going on behind the scenes. So in light of that, there is a Freedom of Information meeting being held at Maplewood Library July 16th. That's a Thursday night, I believe. Is that a Thursday or Wednesday? No, it's a Thursday night. Today's the 2nd. We got that on there. From 6:30 to 8 p.m. Freedom of Information. And this will teach you, I believe Rich Neumeister will be there, who's an expert down at the legislature a lot on freedom of information issues and legislation. It will teach you how to do that, how to get the information, what to say, what laws to cite, and so that you know you can do it on your own and get that information. Now, in part, you have to have the knowledge and the understanding of what to do, but also you need to elect honest and transparent people to office that will write the laws to have an open government, because that is not always the case. Not everybody wants to have this open government and information to be public. So there's many aspects to this, but what's important about this Freedom of Information meeting is it's about you. It's about your ability to get information from the government so you can hold them accountable. Or you don't even have to do that. You can just find out information. What's going on? How did something happen that you thought was a little weird or whatever? You can get that information now. Okay, so July 16th, 6:30 to 8 p.m., Maplewood Library. I think you'll find it a great event to be at. Of course, I'm doing my show at 8 o'clock. I won't be there. We will be filming it. It will be filmed so that we can play clips of that, or you can watch it on cable sometime in the future. We'll let you know on that. All right, this is a live call-in show, so feel free to call in for July 2nd. If it's not July 2nd when you're watching this, could be a replay, don't call in. But if you want to call in, 651-747-3838. If you don't want to call in, you can email me at speechlessmn@gmail.com, and you can watch our past shows, youtube.com/speechlessmn. We'd love to have you watch the past shows. We'd also I'd love your comments, and I appreciate them. Sometimes they're encouraging. No, they're always encouraging. All right. Hey, just a little information. It's kind of a Minnesota issue. You know, Donald Trump is running for president of the United States, and he made some comments about Hispanics. And because of that, NBC dropped Donald Trump from showing the Miss America pageant, or dropped the Miss America pageant because Donald Trump owns it and is running it and has the rights to it. And so there's been some fallout because of what Donald has said. You know, one of the interesting things about what he said was, you know, and I may be parsing this a little too much. I thought he was a little over top on what he said. But when he said Mexico isn't sending us their best, I think kind of there's an aspect. When Mexico sends people to the United States, in other words, they're getting rid of some of their bad people and kind of encouraging them and giving them way into the United States. But there's a lot of good people on their own coming to the United States. You know, that's how I would put it. But if Mexico was sending them, there may not be so good. But that's just a hard life for those people coming over. And many women are getting raped by the people that are bringing them over. And it's a sad deal. And maybe we'll talk. We talked about border issues before, but it isn't anywhere. It's just not about Mexicans coming to the United States. About they come across the Mexican border from many, many other countries, and terrorists and all kinds of things. So it's a bad deal. Something needs to happen. But anyway, the Minnesota connection here on the Miss America pageant, because NBC dropped the Miss America pageant, is now the cable channel Reels, called REELZ, now has the exclusive rights, or they brought the exclusive rights to the Miss America pageant. And what Reels does is they specialize in older movies, but they have entertainment shows and comedy shows, and they have newer shows there too, but they specialize in older movies. They have about 60% of the shows. It's in about 60% of the home, so there should still be a good showing for the Miss America pageant. Here's what's interesting. The CEO of Reels is Stan Hubbard. Of course, he owns KSTP and Channel 5, so which is, I believe, an ABC channel. So that's very, very interesting aspect there. So Stan Halbert, being the entrepreneur that he is, sees an opportunity to go and pick up some money and get the Miss America show at a discount. So anyway, it's going to be showed July 12th, the Miss America pageant. So on Reels, interesting. So now Minnesota has a big connection to the Miss America pageant. Okay, let's see. Let's talk about Minnesota here. The free enterprise system we got going. Dayton in the news today. You know, it's coming out. Dayton made a big pay raise to his commissioners. Those that were making about $130,000 now making $155,000. That's a $35,000 pay increase. But the increases, depending on the executive, went from $20,000 to $84,000 pay increase. Of course, the Met Council chairman went from a part-time $61,000 to a full-time $145,000 a year. And these pay salaries are larger than the salaries of the governor himself. And of course, that was something that was put into law by the DFL so that school board members can get, school board superintendents or other members could, school superintendents could get a higher pay. And and of course, one of the things that's saying, hey, these people that are going into the public sector here could be getting paid 10 times in the private sector, you know, if they're out in the private sector. However, here's a problem. These people are already in these jobs. They're already there. So they decided to go from the private to the public sector already. Okay, and so why do they need the big pay raise? You know, if there are these public servants, they don't, you know, that they're saying they're doing a public good, they're still getting paid. You know, I just, that mindset just boggles me that because you're a public servant, you're doing something great, but you're getting paid for what you're doing. And otherwise, you know, you may not have been there. You know, so, but this was an interesting process because in February 5th, Dayton announced he was going to give the raises. And then in February 12th of 2015, the DFL suspends the raises until July 1st. Oh, also on these commissioners, they already had gotten a 5% pay raise for each year for the last 2 years. So they were seeing, you remember, somebody at the high end of the pay scale, if they get a 1% raise, that's a big jump in salary. But you get a 5% raise, that's a huge jump in salary when you're already making. If you're making $100,000, you know, over 2 years, that's at least $110,000 or a $10,000 raise over 2 years. Where a person who's making $20,000 get a $10,000 raise, that'd be a 30% raise. That's a huge, huge raise during that time. You know, you work it that way. And you know, kind of one of his statements that he made, this that Governor Dayton, it says it may be hard for Minnesotans to take this, to understand this. You know, well, yeah, we shouldn't understand it. It shouldn't be happening, okay? And you got to remember that the DFL had control of the House, the Senate, and the governorship, so they could do anything they wanted to. And during that time, the legislature voted and gave Dayton the freedom to decide commissioner pay. That was written into the law. Okay, and so Republicans had no say in this salary cap. But this is all DFL. This is all the governor's doing. And so this time around, when it came up in the legislature, the DFL had to suspend the pay raises that Dayton said he was going to give his commissioners, which the DFL had already approved him to give in the prior legislation. But now the Senate comes back, the DFL Senate comes back and says, whoa, don't do that. But then during the legislative season, the Senate said, okay, you get 1 day to raise the salaries of these commissioners and these people you want to raise the salary for, and that's July 1st. Just one, if you don't do it on July 1st, that's it, you don't get to do it. So, of course, Dayton does it on July 1st. And, of course, kind of the whole thing is, okay, no more raises. Well, there's always the next legislative season, so he can give a raise anyway. So is it done and over with? No, absolutely not. And you saw what the Ramsey County Board of Commissioners, they gave themselves a big raise, and they kept giving themselves raises. So they're not going to stop giving themselves raises. Interesting stuff. So understand, Dayton's a trust fund baby, you know, and he gives this pay raise for, you know, averaging median around $29,000 a person, and that's equivalent to the median salary of Americans, and they're already making good money. So it just doesn't make sense that he's doing this, and it's a real, I don't know, it just doesn't need to happen. Of course, the reality here is this is all kickback and campaign donations in my mind. You know, we'll give you a raise, but, you know, some of that raise is going to, you give it back to the party and fund the party that way. So that's how the taxpayers end up funding these DFL parties, I'm sorry, the political parties for their campaigns. We'll give you a raise. but give us some money back because we gave you the raise. That's how it works. All right. Okay, something came out today as required by law every year. Let's bring this up here. There has to be a report to the legislature on abortions in Minnesota and where they're coming from, who's doing them. There's a whole lot of things, abortions by the month and the provider, abortions by the month and provider for physicians, the race of the women. They singled out Hispanic origins of women. I don't know why they did that. As a separate thing, Hispanic versus all other. Why didn't they include all of them with just the race of the women? Who knows? Education level of the women, the procedure that was used. You know, a lot of interesting statistics in this report. The one that I really found it interesting. This one floored me. Let's see if I can find it again. Well, it wasn't a surprise to me from hearing what all these abortion doctors have talked about in the past. Before we get into that, though, you know, there's one physician, you know, 161 abortions in January 2014. Well, that kind of doubled their number. They were down around 100 the rest of the time. Must have had some big Christmas bills to pay off, and so had to do a lot more abortions. 118, here's one that's averaging, it looks like, about 100. Did 1,571 for the full year. So that's about 125 a month, somewhere in there. A lot of abortions. Here's one doing about 80 a month, or excuse me, 80 a year. And of course, Planned Parenthood did the most in Minnesota, just short of 5,000 abortions this year. Minnesota had an increase in abortions this year, around 10,123 that's reported. Next biggest was Whole Women's Health Clinic. I just love Whole Women's Health clinics, and they're killing the woman's baby. You know, they're ripping it out piece by piece. Third trimester abortions. Most abortions were prior to 9 weeks, which I found very interesting because one, you know, we played some clips of an abortion doctor that would say, we just lied to a woman. If a woman thought she was pregnant, we say, well, don't you want to make sure? You know, the test came back negative, but don't you want to make sure? You know, because tests can be wrong. And so they do an abortion anyway, and they just scrape off the lining of the uterus and say, see, that was your baby, and that supports the blob mindset. And so they're performing these abortions on women who aren't even pregnant, you know. But how is that woman supposed to know? She's living in fear that she's pregnant or whatever, and there's really no reason to live in fear. Just deal with it. I understand it could be tough, but you know, you're gonna make it. It's the bottom line. So many people out there that want to help, and so many agencies that want to help. Yeah, the age of women with abortions, less than 15 years. There was 30 Minnesota residents, 32 occurring in Minnesota, so two people. Under 15 years of age, how many of those under 15 were reported as statutory rapes? You know, they can figure out who the man was that did this. So there's 30 crimes that have been committed right there in Minnesota. I don't think we've heard a lot about who those criminals are. And so whoever's doing the abortion is covering up for the crime, more than likely. Don't know, because, you know, even though these abortion clinics are required by law to report these abortions, you know, as a crime. Hey, there's something wrong here. This needs to be checked into. The abortion is still legal, but the act of getting somebody pregnant, having sex with somebody under 15 years old, or 15 years old or under, could very well be a crime. And so, you know, what's happening there? That's an interesting thing that would need to be found out. Small number, 19 years and under, you know, less than 1,000 abortions. Most of the abortions in the age group was 25 to 29 years. Oh, I'm sorry, 20 to 24 years. And the 2,800 abortions, another 300 coming from outside of Minnesota. And 2,500 Minnesotans had abortions 25 through 29 years of age. 40 years and over, 363. You know, and just to that, you know, my mom was 42 years old when she had Todd, or my brother. What a blessing that's been. It's just, it's too bad to see that happen. How the girls got married was really interesting. Or what contraceptive they used and still got pregnant. Many of them didn't use any in the process. So they weren't using any contraceptives or male contraceptives or anything like that. Here, less than 9 weeks, 6,000 of the abortions, 6,600 of the abortions done in Minnesota were 9 weeks or less. 9 to 10 weeks, 1,300. But 21 to 24 weeks, 78 abortions. So 80 were kind of late in the program. I mean, these 20 weeks, you know, past 20 weeks, that baby can live outside. You know, there isn't any problem with that. I mean, there could be complications, but most babies are viable outside the womb at 24 weeks. They're always viable inside the womb. That's where they grow, you know. So no third trimester abortions, so they say, just because it's when they have the cutoff date for the second trimester. That's interesting. All right, so how many people had eight, nine or more abortions? There's six people with nine or more abortions. Number of previous live births, nine or more babies. Some people had previous live births and some had more than nine kids. So 20 of them had more than nine kids and then had an abortion. Okay, contraceptive use or method. Now, this is why I'm bringing this up is because this is a big issue with what these abortion doctors do. So, out of all the 10,000 approximate abortions, 600 in Minnesota, women did not provide information about 688. Women did not know whether she used contraception, about 181. Women has never used contraceptives, about 800. Women has used contraceptives, but not at the time of conception, 5,331. Now, of course, these are just for women with abortions. Women used contraceptives at the time of conception, 3,127. They were using contraceptives at the time of conception. 3,000 of them. So what happened? You know, so for those having abortions, that's, you know, 33%, 31% of these women, it didn't work for those having abortions. Other women, they kept their babies where the contraceptives didn't work. Okay, so what's happening? Why isn't it working? Well, what was the method used? The number one reason, women had babies and they were using contraceptives and it didn't work, was because of condoms. 1,300 of the condoms didn't work. Okay, we showed you the Planned Parenthood doctor, the abortion doctor that said, I don't know if it was Planned Parenthood doctor, but said, hey, we have them use condoms because we know it won't work because there's such a high rate of failure for condoms and we make more money. So we pass out the condoms and we know they're not going to work. You're dealing with kids, you're dealing with irresponsible adults. Things are going to happen, they're not going to work. Some of the condoms are going to fail anyway. And guess what? They're going to get pregnant. Oh, I didn't want to be pregnant. They come have the abortion and ka-ching, we get more money. That's the big deal there. We get more money. So that was an interesting. The second highest reason a method used was other, 774. So we don't know what that is. So the real second hundred, they used combination pills. So out of all the methods used of contraceptives, there's just a lot of them that didn't work. So the bottom line, you got to be more responsible than just using contraceptives because it doesn't work. Here's the other big thing in here. 10,000 Minnesotans, and since the beginning of Roe v. Wade, we're talking, you know, since 73 to 2014. So what is that, 41 years? We're talking about around 609,000 abortions. Minnesotans are being aborted in Minnesota, most of them Minnesotans. So we're taking our posterity as Minnesotans and we've killed off 600, you know, 15% of our population. You know, if we're at 4.5 million, 15% of our population we killed off. They would have been human beings. They would have been alive. Of course, they wouldn't have been a horse or a dog. They would have been human beings. Of course, if you feel differently, they could have been a horse, I guess. That's a inside joke for those promoting gender identity. You are what you feel. Okay. 38% of these abortions were paid for with taxpayer funds. You know, this violates, and of course this deals with the Supreme Court in marriage, you can have your religious beliefs, but you can't practice them. Okay, you can't have a behavior that is associated around your religious belief. Of course, the Muslim faith can have their behavior, but the Christians can't have theirs. As a matter of fact, we're going to take your money to pay for these abortions. So, which violates the tenets of Christianity. Also, not kill. Okay, so, and that's what an abortion is. It's a killing. 38% were paid for, but with taxpayer funds. And you and I had to pay for them. And that violates my religious beliefs. That violates my religious freedoms. 49% were performed by Planned Parenthood, more than any other provider. And this is key. Planned Parenthood built a huge facility down there just a block off of University in Vandalia, kind of right, you know, real close to where SPNN and now has their studios. So the whole reason they built this huge, big building was because of Obamacare and all the money that was going to be coming into abortions because of Obamacare. And we see the government kind of, there's a workings on going on where they're just funneling everything to Planned Parenthood and they're being able to charge a lot more money for abortions so that they can pay for this huge building and increase the staffs there. So that's what's going on, why Planned Parenthood's increasing so much. 28% of the abortions use the dangerous and sometimes lethal RU486 abortion drug. So we really don't know the medical complications. Maybe that was in the study, I didn't see it far enough, but how many of these women had medical complications. But you do see ambulances leaving these abortion clinics. And what happened in Texas, just the U.S. Supreme Court put a stay on a Texas ruling that where the Texas law said that if you're going to be an abortion clinic, you have to have hospital capable, you have to be clean, okay? You have to be sanitary, you have to have inspections. And that forced half of the abortion services out of the industry. You had to be close to a hospital in case something went wrong. So half the abortion facilities in Texas closed down, and they're about ready to see another half close down until the U.S. Supreme Court put a stay on it. It means they're saying, okay, that law is not going to be, don't enforce that law. Of course, Texas can go and say, you know what, U.S. Supreme Court, no, this is Texas. Until you rule otherwise, no, we have jurisdiction here, you don't. And of course, that's what Alabama is doing on a number of issues. And we'll get into that a little bit later. But Texas can say no. And so we'll see what Texas does. But the Supreme Court said, no, it's okay. Otherwise, another half of these abortion mills would have closed real soon, within a couple weeks. But so the U.S. Supreme Court then is going to figure that out and decide, hey, whether you have to have a clean abortion facility or not. I mean, you know, we're all concerned about women's health, but you don't have to sterilize the utensils in between abortions. You know, just kind of outrageous. Okay, well, that's a lot of just an interesting, this is kind of the, this is a sad state for Minnesota, you know, to be in this situation. It needs to be talked about. And how the mindset of the people of Minnesota who permit such things, or the justices that said, yeah, abortions, yeah, it's a liberty issue, you get to do it. 27% of the women reported economic reasons as why they had the abortion. So they sold their kid for money, is basically. 69% of the women reported does not want children at this time. I don't know, what does it say about women? What does it say about men? What does it say about Minnesota? I don't think it's something good. What does it say about human nature? I don't think this is anything good. And, you know, if you take it from a religious perspective or a biblical perspective, this is not good. And for Minnesota, for the United States, and biblically, judgment. That's all that there is. That's all that is waiting for the United States, is judgment by God, biblically. Whether you think it happens or not, I'm just saying that's what the Bible says. And God is patient. But when his patience stops, it's over. Okay? And you don't want to be there when that happens. Not at all. Okay. I take that back. I don't take that back. I mean, about the wrath of God here. Abortion complications. 20 complications were reported by women at the time of the abortion, including cervical lacerations and hemorrhaging. Yikes. That means when they're having the abortion, the doctor put that instrument too far and lacerated the cervix. 62 complications have been reported by women after leaving the abortion provided, including incomplete abortions, failed abortions, and hemorrhage. Okay, so there is risk, and it'd be interesting to see where those providers and came from. Okay. Now we're going to talk a little bit about an issue that happened in Arizona. And this is about parental rights and what's taking place with parents kind of all across the nations at one time or another. But you see social workers do this and people get threatened and you as a parent don't know what to do. And social workers will come in, you better let us come into your house or we're going to take your kids. So there's a threat. And of course, you as a parent that haven't been trained in the Constitution, what do you do? You know, how do you deal with that? And so it's scary, and not everybody makes the right decision. But, you know, one county in Arizona had a situation where a social worker and a deputy standing at the door said, let us in and look around or we'll remove your children. Of course, they have to have a search warrant, but, you know, what do you do? And this happened to a couple in Arizona, and Joe Arpaio, who's a sheriff down there, was sued because he's a sheriff. But I don't think he would have done this. But when human services, sometimes the executive branch, other people higher up, the human services tells the executive branch, deputy, you better do this. And, the deputies go and do it. Are they there to support the human services people? But evidently there was a complaint against this family. And they went to the family and said, showed up at the door, if you don't let us in to look around, we're going to take your children. And the parents didn't let them in. And of course, this is an emergency situation. And the parents didn't let them in, at least according to the county. And then the social worker said, okay, you got 2 months to make up your mind, or we're going to take your kids. Oh, wait, if it's an emergency situation, why the 2 months? If it's an emergency situation, why not a search warrant? So what's really going on here? So eventually the family they made a decision, okay? And it started in 2006. And the social service workers and the deputies arrived at the home of John and Tiffany Loudermilk, that's where the social service worker issued the ultimatum, not the deputy. While it's hard to reconcile, there was this 2-month delay to any claim of imminent danger to the children. Nevertheless, the social service workers began writing up the paperwork while the Loudermilks wrestled with their decision. Finally, afraid of the trauma that removal would cause their children, and it causes the children trauma and the parents. I mean, that matters too. You know, it's not just the children, it's the parents. They permitted that the house be searched, and they found nothing, and the anonymous tip had been unwarranted and left the home. Understand, anonymous tip without a search warrant, okay? What that means is the police can come into your house at any time they want. Get a social worker there. Hey, we don't need a search warrant. We just got a social worker. Just bring a social worker along. Who needs a search warrant? We can say it's, you're mistreating the kids, and then go look for something else, you know. Oh, no kids missing. There's this over here. So we searched your house without a search warrant. And that's what's been happening in the civil law community, where, you know, in criminal law, you have rights. But in civil law, they've worked out situations where they've criminalized civil law. But since it's under civil law, you don't have these rights. And attorney after attorney I've talked to has struggled with this. What do we do? But the legislature keeps writing these types of laws, and the court kind of, you know, blinks their eye. Oh, it's a greater good here that's being accomplished. Well, we don't know that, and I actually don't think a greater good is being accomplished. So what the Loudermilks decided to do, even though they weren't charging anything, the kids never left the home, they decided to sue in order to stop the injustice from happening to a lot of other people. That's a stand-up person. In other words, they're not being arrested, the kids aren't being taken away, but they recognize this as being wrong. So they went and sued, and this went all the way to the, and of course the deputies were being sued in this, and it went to the U.S. Ninth Circuit. And here's what the U.S. Ninth Circuit, surprise, surprise, said. The deputies have immunity. Okay, they, in doing their job, they just get this immunity, even though they invaded the home without a warrant or imminent threat, yet they did it under the color of law. So this is the type of thing that happens in Minnesota. It happens all over. But finally, somebody stood up. Maybe they had some money. Who knows? Well, the parentalrights.org is supporting this and helping them in this process. The Homeschool Legal Defense Association is also helping them with the lawsuit too. So now this whole situation is going to the U.S. Supreme Court. However, there's no guarantee that the U.S. Supreme Court will hear this, but that raises this whole situation of immunity from executive branch people. Oh, it's the police, they get immunity. Oh, it's a judge, judicial immunity. You know, they commit these terrible acts and abuse of nature, and you know, who cares? Well, they get immunity. You know, you and I don't get that immunity if we mess up, you know, unintentional mistake. But judges intentionally making bad decisions, intentionally violating the law and violating constitutional rights, they don't have any accountability. And that's just kind of the big thing. Michelle McDonald, who ran for the Minnesota Supreme Court, with Judge David Knutson, you know, the Eighth Circuit here, oh, the judge had immunity. He can do whatever he wants. You know, he didn't commit a crime, he just made a decision that destroyed a person's finances and took away the kids, and, you know, who cares? You know? Oh, you can just appeal it and, you know, 5 years later figure this out. You know, it's just terrible what we got going. So that's a big lawsuit, and hopefully the U.S. Supreme Court will take it up, and we'll try to stay on top of that one because it's essential to our rights as parents to raise our kids and to have the protections. And this aspect of liberty is crucial. Liberty to raise your kids in the education and religion of your choice, and upbringing of your choice. You know, this freedom of religion, freedom of speech, these are essential liberties that have been delineated in our Constitution. However, you know, the court is defining liberty a lot broader than what has been defined in the Constitution, of course, with the marriage amendment. And the big thing that has to happen here is the Constitution defines what the judiciary can do. And since there is no mention of gay marriage in the Constitution, the judges shouldn't be dealing with this issue at all. And they shouldn't be writing law and making law for the people because it's not delineated as a liberty. Okay, and then you got to define what liberty means. But here's what needs to happen, and what I was doing some research. There's a joint resolution, which is a constitutional amendment in relationship to marriage, and that it would be declaring that marriage is between a man and a woman. So it would be placed into the United States Constitution. It's something that needs to happen. It's the same reason that we need to place into our Constitution the right for parents to raise their children, the education, upbringing of their choice. That doesn't mean a parent can abuse a child. Okay, doesn't mean that, because you write laws to say this is abuse. Here's what you can't do. Okay, and if you're beating your kids over the head and causing damage, that's a crime. So we delineate what a crime is. So if you're going to take the kids away from a parent, the law has to say why. And what's happening, like with the louder mix, that the law has just been, the line has just been grayed over. So that you now, search warrant, who cares, you don't need that. We can just threaten you and make you do things based on the threat that you don't want to do. That's not what this country is about. But because our executive branch is behaving this way and the judicial branch is upholding that and legislatures are writing bad law, it's we the people that have to go and change our Constitution to make it clear as to what government can and cannot do. And on the Parental Rights Amendment, to raise your children in the upbringing of choice, your upbringing choice, that's important to put in the Constitution now, because most people believe that, okay, and want that. And therefore, you put it in now in order that you don't have the situation coming down the pike like what happened with the marriage amendment, okay? And that should have been put in the Constitution about 10 years ago. So you have to have foresight as to what's coming down the line. Now, pretty soon, the big target with this Supreme Court ruling, the end result is what's being pushed here, is to take away a church's tax-exempt status. Of course, then they wouldn't have freedom of religion because it's taxed. Okay? That's why churches don't have to pay taxes, is because they have freedom of religion. If you're free, you're not licensed, fined, or taxed. So that's kind of one of the whole goals. And of course, another goal is to destroy the family, redefine the family, the social structure unit, so then everybody's dependent on the government rather than on a mom and a dad that work to put their family and keep their family together and have the social welfare system work through the family rather than through the government. And that's why we need these constitutional amendments, to get our courts right. Okay, to limit our courts. Now, I had something to read here. Oh yeah, I gotta flip this over. Justice Thomas, my favorite justice. I gotta show you that picture I have with him. It's a great picture. I was just telling him that in Minnesota we have a very corrupt judiciary, and he kind of, what? You know, and the picture was taken, what? You know, when he's leaning back, he goes, I don't know about this, do I? I says, nah, I doubt it. They cover it up pretty well here. Anyway, I got to bring that in so you can see it. Justice Thomas had to say, I personally think he's one of the smartest guys up there. The court's decision today is at odds not only with the Constitution, but with the principles upon which our nation was built. And of course, the other justices, they didn't care. You know, the petitioners make strong arguments rooted in social policy and considerations of fairness. Right there, that tells you that judge is on a political ideology rather than upholding our Constitution. what the legislature needs to do to Justice Kennedy and these five justices that wrote this decision, they need to be impeached. You know, they need to be impeached for what they've done. And it's just terrible. All right, so let's go back to what Thomas had to say here. Since well before 1787, liberty has been understood as freedom from government action, not entitlement to government benefits. There it is. This is the big switch. Freedom, liberty has been understood as freedom from government action. In other words, the government can't come in and search your house without a search warrant. You have the right to travel around without the government interfering within your travel, without just cause or due process. Okay, and so this whole aspect of liberty has changed from freedom from government action to now freedom and liberty to get government benefits. And that's not what it's about. The framers created our Constitution to preserve that understanding of liberty. Yet the majority invokes our Constitution in the name of a liberty that the framers would not have recognized, to the detriment of the liberty they sought to protect. Along the way, it rejects the idea captured in our Declaration of Independence that human dignity is innate and suggests instead that it comes from the government. You know, human dignity comes from the government. Right. This distortion of our Constitution not only ignores the text, it inverts the relationship between the individual and the state in our republic. I cannot agree with it. Very, very good statements by Justice Thomas. The majority's decision today will require states to issue marriage license to same-sex couples and to recognize same-sex marriages entered in other states, largely based on a constitutional provision guaranteeing due process before a person is deprived of his life, liberty, or property. I have elsewhere explained that the dangerous fiction of treating the due process clause as a font of substantive rights, McDonald versus Chicago, it distorts the constitutional text, which guarantees only whatever process is due before a person is deprived of life, liberty, or property. In other words, when you go to a jury trial and you go through the process that has been established through our Constitution, you have a right to a jury, whatever, you don't have a right to what the jury decides. Okay? You know, if the jury decides against you, that's not a violation of due process rights. There may be other violations of due process rights because the judge didn't properly inform the jury, or the judge said, okay, instead of you having 12 jurors, you only get 10. And of course, that's ridiculous. They don't do that. But that would be an example. The outcome of the decision is not a due process violation. Okay, so that's what he's talking about. So, but that's the nature of this gay marriage things. Not being able to recognize homosexual couples as married, there's no due process violation. There's no right guaranteed in our Constitution for it. So how can you claim due process violation? Nobody violated any due process for you. It's insane. So it distorts the constitutional text, which guarantees only whatever process is due before a person is deprived of life, liberty, and property. Worse, that's Constitution Amendment 14, Section 1. Worse, it invites judges to do exactly what the majority has done here, roam at large in the constitutional field, guided only by their personal views as to the fundamental rights protected by that document. Big, big statements, big, big sayings. Very good. By straying from the text of the Constitution, substantive due process exalts judges at the expense of the people from whom they derive their authority. Petitioners argue that by enshrining the traditional definition of marriage in their state constitutions through voter-approved amendments, the states have put the issue beyond the reach of normal democratic process. Wow. Folks, we're in trouble. Big-time trouble. You can't mock the Constitution. You can't mock God in so many ways through abortion, gay marriage. You can't do it and get away with it. All right. Remember, people, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. So God bless. Have a happy 4th of July. Celebrate our independence and forced taxation so they have to pay for abortions now. God bless America. All right. We'll see you next week.